Well, the 23rd of April, 1616, a long time ago. In this day, William Shakespeare and Miguel de Cervantes die. This extraordinary coincidence about the fate of two of the greatest figures in the world's literature, commonly regarded as the most important authors in English and Spanish literature, brought UNESCO to declare today the World Book and Copyright Day. So we are here in the library to celebrate the book, our love for it, and the pleasure of reading. And since this is a special year for ICTP, as it marks the 50th anniversary, we have chosen to take a trip back in time and try to discover through our readings the reasons why there was a need for this center back then, how this project was pursued, and how it ended and why it ended up in Trieste. All this in the words of our founders and their biographers, read by our colleagues and friends at ICTP, taken from texts that we have in our collection in the Marie Curie Library. This is the story of how Abdus Salam and Paolo Budinich independently developed visions of international cooperation in science, which ultimately emerged to create the ICTP in Trieste. The story begins a long time ago, in 1951, at the Government College of Lahore, Pakistan.
From A Guide to the Early History of the Abdus Salam International Center for Theoretical Physics, The Dream of a Young Physicist. The idea of an international center for theoretical physics was born from the personal experience of a young Pakistani physicist who, after brilliant studies in England, returned to his native country as a professor of physics, and who was soon faced with a realization that his career as a scientist on the competitive edge was irremediably compromised if he remained in his home university. The only alternative for him was to return to England or to move to any other industrialized country where his talent would be recognized and encouraged. This young physicist was Abdus Salam.
Back in Pakistan, having completed his PhD thesis, only waiting to get the degree, Salam thought of going back to Pakistan to serve his country as a teacher and researcher. He could formally submit his thesis from there at the end of the three-year period to get his PhD, so he returned to Pakistan in 1951 and joined the Government College, Lahore, as professor and head of the mathematics department. Salam, however, now belonged to a breed of men different from those he had been meeting as a student within the same college. He has started working at the very frontiers of physics while at Cambridge, and his appetite for in-depth research knew almost no bounds. There was no tradition of research at Government College, Lahore, and teaching was taken to be the primary concern of the teachers. The principal of the college in the very first encounter with Salam told him in so many words that research was low on the list of priorities in the scheme of the things at the college. Instead, he offered Salam three choices for any spare hours he might have after his teaching duties. He could either be the chief treasurer of the college accounts or be the warden of a hostel of the college, or else he could elect to be the president of the football club. Salam chose the latter, it being the most interesting of the choices available, but he felt intellectually very lonely and frustrated. He could not interact with any physicist on the subject at the very frontiers of physics, always churning in his mind, and there was hardly any climate for research in the college or even in the country. The intellectual isolation at Lahore frustrated him to the extreme, and he had to choose between physics, which was now his first love, and his country. Salam overcame his sentiments and chose physics.
Thank you. Aisha, who just read this chapter, comes from the Department of Mathematics of the Government College of Lahore. It is now named after Abdus Salam. And in the meantime, in Trieste,
this is from Good Morning, Professor Budinic by Pietro Greco. We had left Paolo Budinic in the mid-50s, just back from Zurich, and about to organize l'Istituto di Fisica dell'Università di Trieste, of which he became director. His hope was that he would take off, so that free from responsibility, he could dedicate himself to research. Although in the preceding years, Budinic had succeeded in inserting Trieste into the Istituto Nazionale di Fisica Nucleare Network, conceived and created by Eduardo Amaldi, the fact remained that the Physics Institute of the Julian University was small, and that Trieste was a peripheral center with no science tradition and without organic contacts with the world of physics. It was necessary to end this isolation. To go beyond Trieste, this was his goal as director, and it very soon became his main work commitment. Paolo decided on a two-pronged strategy to achieve it. One might call Italian, and the other international. In order to end its isolation, it was necessary to project Trieste into the mainstream of physics, which mattered. The truth is that in 1955, although it had finally become Italian, the city had still not found its identity. 40 years earlier, Trieste had its identity. It was a great empire's outlet to the sea, the strategic port of Austria-Hungary. Its rich and dynamic economy had been dominated by a commercial and financial middle class. Its insurance companies were already important, with a marked cosmopolitan character. Its culture was Middle European, but with an original Mediterranean vein. After 1918, Trieste found itself on the geographic, cultural, and economic margins of a young nation, with which it did not always get on, Italy. It was no longer a strategic port of an empire, but an average border city. Trade declined, cultural ties with Central Europe became frayed. Tensions simmered between various ethnic groups, particularly between Italians and Slavs. Everything grew worse during the 20 years of fascism, with the notorious program of Italianization of the regions and people of Slovenia and Croatia. The Budinics, too, were forced to abandon their Slav name and Italianize it as Budini. And then there was the Second World War and its aftermath, the 40 days of Tito, the Allied administration, the Iron Curtain, full return to Italy, from which events negotiations the city was largely excluded, and the separation from Istria, felt as the loss of part of itself, of what remained of its identity. Links with the East were interrupted. Those with Italy and the rest of the world were difficult. Trieste had no motorway, no airport, apart from the small military base at Ronchi. Down at the port, traffic of men and goods was reduced to a fraction of what it had been 40 years earlier. In short, in the mid-50s, the economy was in a state of collapse. Unemployment was rising. The city suddenly felt old, and not only metaphorically. The average age of the population had in fact begun to rise. It was in this city that Budinic began to pursue his utopia and to believe that he could build an important physics institute. Despite everything, it wasn't a baseless hope, at least not a hope without a contest. Something had remained in the city. Structurally, there were the great insurance companies. Culturally, there was a mixed group of intellectuals of Middle European education and cosmopolitan by vocation. So the second strategic line taken by Paolo Budinic wasn't a sudden bolt from the blue. He set down his roots in the still living culture of his city. Its isolation had to be ended, an advantage taken of the city's geographic and geopolitical position to insert it into a central European network of scientific culture. In fact, to place it at the center of a tightly woven network of research institutes capable of breaching the Iron Curtain, which, as Churchill had said, stretched across Europe from Stettin to Trieste. Of course, the network was still to be created. However, it did not prove too difficult to begin waving it. Thus, we have the head of the Instituto di Fisica dell'Università di Trieste, armed with his contacts with Göttingen and Zurich, committed to organizing meetings and seminars with his friends from Vienna, Walter Thiering, from Ljubljana, Milan Osredkar, Zagreb, Ivan Supek, and Budapest, George Marx. Very soon, the contacts became a project called the European Network, and was presented for approval to UNESCO, the United Nations Agency with Responsibility for Culture. The idea was based on the conviction that in order to reach levels of quality comparable to those of the best institutes in the most scientifically advanced countries, a critical mass was required, which none of the small central countries were capable of achieving. In short, the network was not a flight of fancy, but a pressing cultural necessity. Budinich even imagined what shape it would take. Austria, with Vienna, where his friend Stirling was, and Graz would specialize in theoretical and nuclear physics. Zagreb, where physicists were building a particle accelerator, in experimental nuclear physics. Budapest, in molecular biology. Trieste should offer itself as a center for electronic calculus, able to serve the whole network via telephone. UNESCO approved. And so in 1957, delegations from the various countries met in Paris at the agency's headquarters to draw up and endorse a memorandum of understanding. Many believed in it. Hungary and Yugoslavia had ministers leading their delegations. At the meeting, there was a representative of the Soviet Union as an observer. Paolo Budinich represented Italy on behalf of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, who had authorized him to sign, subject to later ratification by the government. An understanding was reached and the memorandum signed. Then, for months, the delegates waited for UNESCO to send them the final approval documents, but there was no news from Paris. After ever more green and irritated requests for an explanation, UNESCO declared that there had been a formal error, that according to special diplomatic taxonomy, this type of meeting was controversial and its actions were invalid. The unofficial explanation going around the corridors, but not far from the truth, was that the Soviet Union had exercised a veto. It would not tolerate the creation of open zones or collaboration between East and West in that delicate part of Europe. Even less so when the areas of collaboration included Yugoslavia, the communist country that had broken with Moscow. The idea had failed. The first experiment on the international front had ended in a fiasco. On the national front, too, Budinich's attempt to set up in Trieste a Scuola Normale Superiore on the lines of the one in Pisa ended in defeat. And the young and brilliant physicist who had come to Trieste departed, called to important posts at most prestigious places, precisely because they were young and brilliant. Pietro Bassi transferred to Bologna, Carlo Franzinetti to Turin, Daniele Matti to CERN at Geneva. The 1950s drew to a close. Trieste had still not found its identity, and Paolo Budinich had to begin again from scratch.
Luigi Stasi was at the time administrative director of the University of Trieste and then became secretary of the International Foundation for the Progress and Freedom of Sciences, recalls.
So from Witness of the Dream of Trieste by Luigi Stasi. In his Trieste in My Memories, Gianni Stuparich, a renowned writer and humanist, wrote prophetically in 1948, "I have a suspicion which on one hand disheartens me, but on the other hand encourages me to hope. Trieste has turned its back to a humanistic culture by tradition and left it to others who are better fit for it. But it has the possibility of a new and modern culture, a culture which will be lively in tomorrow's Europe and which will be a merge of civilization from south and the north, from the east and the west, one of the pivots of the bridge which Italy could be in the future between the millenarian Mediterranean civilization and the other civilization of the world." In 1960, at the General Conference of the International Atomic Energy Agency in Vienna, a man of faith and of science who came from the Orient as the delegate of Pakistan and whose name, Abdus Salam, means servant of peace, proposed the creation of a center for study and research where men from all nations would work with some of the brightest brains of physics. This idea was opposed by the industrialized countries. During the summer of that year, Abdus Salam was normally based in London, happened to be in Geneva from where he was invited to take part in the International Symposium on International Physics, which Paolo Budinich from the University of Trieste had organized in Miramare. The young professor from Trieste was then dreaming of overcoming the post-war climate of exasperated nationalism by internationalizing the local scientific culture in the university context at the highest level of knowledge. The preaching of the Muslim mystic Abdus Salam and the aspiration of the incurable optimist of Budinich merged into a single creative design. And Trieste submitted its candidature as the seat of the forthcoming International Center of the United Nations, a world meeting place for the physicists in competition with offers from Denmark for Copenhagen, from Pakistan for Lahore, and from Turkey for Ankara.
Abdus Salam and Paolo Budinich meet at a symposium held at Trieste in June 1960, and Salam proposes the creation of an International Center for Theoretical Physics a few months later at the 4th General Conference of the IEA. Budinich learns about the proposal of Salam and immediately starts working on the candidacy of Trieste as the seat of the new center. Budinich wrote to Salam and asked him for his opinion on Trieste as a possible seat for the new institute. Salam's reply was positive and read as follows, 14th of December 1960. Dear Budinich, it has given me great pleasure to learn that there is some possibility of your being able to offer accommodation for the proposed International Institute for Theoretical Physics in Trieste. I'm enclosing the resolution which requested the agency to make a study of the project regarding the institute. The Italian delegation at the agency's meeting was very sympathetic with the resolution, which I had the honor of putting forward, and they voted strongly for the resolution. Trieste has the reputation of an international city, and provided that facilities for education in English were adequate, it could be an ideal place for locating the International Institute. Without making a definite commitment on behalf of the sponsors of the resolution, I would like to express my deepest interest in seeing the Institute located in such a delightful place as Trieste. I very much hope that your efforts prove successful and an offer for accommodation can be made by your department. Yours sincerely, Abdus Salam.
Need for an International Center for Theoretical Physics. Speech delivered by Abdus Salam at the IAEA Annual Conference, Vienna, 1962. Moving the resolution for the creation of the International Center for Theoretical Physics. 2 years back, in September 1960, the Pakistan delegation had the privilege to co-sponsor the first resolution requesting the agency to create an International Center for Theoretical Physics. During these 2 years, the idea has progressed. Firstly, by the generous financial offers from the Danish and the Italian governments to help in setting up such a center, and secondly, by the enthusiastic support the idea has received from the world community of physicists. The panel of physicists, which was convened by the Director General in March 1961, whose report was circulated to member governments, enthusiastically endorsed the idea of the center. They defined its scope and objective and discussed the manner in which it could be set up and run. I shall be referring frequently to the conclusions of this panel. In considering the question of whether the agency should set up a center, there are three questions we should ask ourselves. Does research in theoretical physics fall within the scope of the agency's activities? Do physicists from the emerging countries really need and desire such a center? If the center is desirable, can it be created and can the agency afford it? Let us examine the issue in the light of these three questions. First, does research in theoretical physics fall within the scope of the agency's activities? The submission of the sponsors of the resolution is that there are indeed fewer sciences which have contributed more to the coming of the atomic age than theoretical physics. Even if we ignore the fact that Einstein was the first scientist to dream of equivalence of mass and energy and to create the whole basis of our science, even if we forget that two of the world's leading theoretical physicists, Fermi and Wigner, actually built the world's first atomic reactor, we should not forget that there are still uncharted areas in theoretical plasma physics which are vital to the tapping of fusion power. We must not forget that in spite of all our advances in nuclear physics, we still do not know the theoretical expression for the law of force between two nucleons. These indeed are areas in theoretical physics of direct and immediate concern to the agency, with research in them its major responsibility. Let me name these areas again. These are reactor theory, plasma theory, low energy nuclear theory, theoretical high energy physics. This last may sound on the very speculative side of theoretical physics. But I sometimes wonder what reply an agency like ours may have given to a request of a young and unknown theoretical physicist, Albert Einstein, in 1904, if he had made an application for a fellowship to follow his theoretical speculations on the nature of space and time. Who among us would have dreamt that he would come up also in the same paper with the relationship of energy and mass? Who among us dare say today that a theoretical speculation on the muon fusion may not be relevant to the energy problems of tomorrow? My remarks about theoretical physics and its relevance to the agency's activities are not to deny the role of other scientific disciplines, nor to deny the agency's responsibilities to them. But as we shall see, the claim theoretical physics has rests on one thing peculiar to it. Theoretical physics needs no apparatus. It is the least costly of all sciences. The return relative to cost for this discipline is the highest. If the agency has to choose among fundamental sciences on a tight budget, theoretical physics is undoubtedly the subject of choice. The case for the agency to support theoretical physics gets stronger when we consider this subject from the point of view of the emerging countries. First and foremost, let us not forget that young scientists in the underdeveloped world feel the urge to meet the challenge of fundamental science as much as anyone else. Among the fundamental sciences, theoretical physics has a peculiar fascination for them. First, no costly apparatus is needed. Second, in this field, individual initiative rather than collaborative effort can still lead to a breakthrough. Almost invariably, theoretical physics is the first science in smaller countries which gets developed at the advanced level. History bears this out. This was the case in Japan with Yukawa and Tomonaga. This was the case with India, in Brazil, Turkey, Lebanon, and Argentina. No one can reverse this historical process of the order in which science grows in rich or poor soils. But in spite of the native ability, in spite of the ambitions of these scientists, they, in common with other scientists in their countries, suffer from one fatal disability: isolation. After an initial period of brilliant work at some active center, they are faced with a cruel choice, either to leave their countries or to ossify and become scientific administrators. Unlike other scientists whose disabilities may include lack of costly equipment and apparatus, the theoretical physicist can be helped at a very small cost by making frequent contacts possible and by awarding him frequent visiting fellowships to live for periods at active centers. An important question asked is, will such a center lure the scientists from the emerging countries away from their homes? Our answer is an emphatic no. On the contrary, the center will help in stemming the torrent of migration. If one is certain of being able to spend periods of a few months working in an active center, the incentive to become a permanent exile considerably decreases. Finally, do the physicists from the underdeveloped countries want such a center? We have before us a document signed by 53 of the participants who attended the seminar at Trieste. Let me read from this document. While important cross-fertilization of ideas has taken place during the 6 weeks of the seminar, the seminar has served to underline the need for a center. In order for important joint work to be done, contact for more than 6 weeks of a summer seminar is necessary. Let us turn now to the third point. Is it possible to create such a center? Can one find three or four distinguished physicists who feel that they would make a more important contribution by joining this center as permanent staff? Would other distinguished men come to this center as visiting professors? We humbly submit that the answer to these questions cannot be given by a debate at a meeting of the Board of Governors. The answer depends on whether the world community of physicists is enthusiastic about such a center. I can only give my personal impressions. I know for a fact that men like Niels Bohr, Hideki Yukawa, Hans Bethe, Robert Oppenheimer, Victor Weizenkopf, Robert Marshak, Julian Schwinger, Abraham Pace, Leopold Infeld, to name but a few, are strongly in favor of an international center. No such center now exists. Once it is created, there are scores of activities it can engage in, like arrangements of seminars in developing countries. Inevitably, the center will become the clearinghouse for new ideas. With it is associated at present the idealism of the world community of theoretical physicists. Gentlemen, let us project to 20 years from now. The world is moving closer, economically, intellectually, scientifically. In 20 years, there will be international research centers not only for theoretical physics, but for most fundamental sciences. The world trend is in this direction, and nothing can stop it. It is possible for us in this agency to take the initiative in forwarding this movement. I do hope very much we shall. With these words, I commend to you the resolution in front of us.
The proposal met with enthusiasm on the part of the developing country delegations, but with a more tepid attitude from the industrialized countries. The first real battle for the creation of the center occurred at the 1962 IAEA General Conference. The Australian delegate said, "Theoretical physics is the Rolls-Royce of sciences. Developing countries do not need Rolls-Royces, they only need donkey carts." Nevertheless, after other vicissitudes, the IAEA decided to create the center in Trieste in 1964.
Afternoon. From a guide to the early history of the Abdus International Center for Theoretical Physics. The meeting of the three wise men. Director General Sigmund Eklund, who had been requested by the Board of Governors to study the offers from member states of facilities, assistance, and cooperation for the future International Center for Theoretical Physics, invited three eminent theoretical physicists to help him in this task. These three experts were Robert Marshak, University of Rochester, USA, Jaime Timignon, Centro Brasileiro de Pesquisas Físicas, Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, and Leon Van Hove, CERN Geneva. They met at the IAEA headquarters in April 63. In the parlance of the ICTP, the report was named Three Wise Men Report. At the June meeting, the board decides that the agency accepts the offer of the Italian government with Trieste as the seat of the ICTP. A restricted town committee is set up in Trieste under the presidency of Paolo Budinich, and officials from the agency visit the city in order to discuss the preparation of a seat agreement, the temporary and permanent buildings for the center, and many other arrangements. Arrangements for the first academic year are finalized. The Scientific Council is constituted and meets at Vienna and at Trieste. The first academic year of the center is inaugurated, and the seminar on plasma physics starts on October 5th, 1964.
So the long road to the creation of ICTP has led us to 1964, to 50 years ago, when the center began with more enthusiasm than resources. So there are a few anecdotes written by Paolo Budinich in his memories that will be read by his son Piero. The book, L'Arcipelago delle Meraviglie, has been published only in Italian. So this part has been translated for this occasion by Martina Horvich, whom I thank, of course. Please.
I particularly remember Alfred Kastler, who won the Nobel Prize for his discoveries in the field of lasers. A man of great culture and humanity, as Frenchmen can be, he came to Trieste for many consecutive years to teach laser physics to young Africans, Asians, Latin Americans, each time residing at the modest Hotel Mignon in the Grignano Bay for several weeks. I am convinced you could spend all the time you are dedicating to us in a much more fruitful manner, I told him, both from a scientific and an economic point of view. Of course, you are right, he answered. For years, the Bell Laboratories in the United States have been asking me to work for them, offering me a daily allowance which is 100 times higher than the one you give me. But you see, our job as researchers is ultimately a great privilege that we are being granted for thanks to the society and to public money. Therefore, through the years, each one of us has accrued an enormous moral debt. By coming here and offering my knowledge to those who really need it, both for their personal interest and for the good of their countries, I feel that I am at least partly paying my debt. In this way, when I go back to the École Normale in Paris to continue with my personal research, my conscience feels at peace. Some of the third world country visitors were very skilled, especially those coming from the former British colonies where the English educational and academic system had been implanted, or those coming from Latin America. For them, ICTP could do a lot. But there were also countries lagging heavily behind, especially in Africa, provided with but rudimental academic structures. For these, there was very little we could do. I also remember a few touching cases, for example, the young Afghan professor whom, for a certain period of time, I would see daily in the ICTP library, destined to become one of Europe's best, busy copying a book. The volume was Eugene Wigner's Group Theory. There were no photocopying machines at the time, so he copied it by hand, fired by the prospect of later being able to teach it at the University of Kabul. Or the case of an extremely gifted young man from Tanzania who had fallen behind with his studies and who once confided to me the reason why. The elementary school he attended was situated 2 miles away from his home. Classes started at 8 o'clock in the morning, but he could never be there before 10 because the road leading to the school intersected with the route the lions took each morning to go to drink at a little lake. He knew the lions passed at approximately 9 o'clock, so he never left home before 9:30.
Well, we are approaching the end of our story, not the end of the story of ICTP, of course, but we have to make it short. And we are glad to do so in the words of Andrea Monde, who has also been author of several passages we already read before. Andrea Monde, former senior administration of ICTP, who spent 30 years with Abdus Salam.
From the book of Dr. Amende, From a Vision to a System. Much has already been said in this book on the saga of Abdus Salam, Paolo Budinich, and the scientists of the International Center for Theoretical Physics. Therefore, I think it proper to confine myself to what one might call daily life at ICTP with Abdus Salam, quote unquote, and in particular to the period preceding the award of the Nobel Prize to the center director in October 79. That year was actually the beginning of a new year for the ICTP. A few months before he received the prize, Abdus Salam was disappointed about the course of development at the center. He told the journalist, "I could not start the center today. No one would listen to me. Government have become short-sighted." For once, he was wrong. The Nobel Prize to our director changed all that.
Yes.
No, no, I have notes. This is from Abdus Salam's Nobel Prize address. Scientific thought and its creation is the common shared heritage of mankind. In this respect, the history of science, like the history of all civilization, has gone through cycles. Perhaps I can illustrate this with an actual example. 760 years ago, a young Scotsman left his native glens to travel south to Toledo in Spain. His name was Michael. His goal, to live and work at the once Arab universities of Toledo and Cordova, where the greatest of Jewish scholars, Moses bin Maimun, had taught a generation before. Michael reached Toledo in 1217 AD. Once in Toledo, Michael formed the ambitious project of introducing Aristotle to Latin Europe, translating not from the original Greek, which he knew not, but from the Arabic translations taught in Spain. From Toledo, Michael traveled to Sicily, to the court of Emperor Friedrich II. Visiting the medical school at Salerno, chartered by Friedrich in 1231, Michael met the Danish physicist Henrik Harpensteig, later to become court physician of Erik Valdemarsson. Henrik had to come to Salerno to compose his treatise on bloodletting and surgery. Henrik's sources were the medical canons of the great Arabic great clinicians of Islam, Al-Razi and Ibn Sina, which only Michael the Scot could translate for him. Toledo's and Salerno's schools, representing as they did the finest synthesis of Arabic, Greek, Latin and Hebrew scholarships, were some of the most memorable of international essays in scientific collaboration. To Toledo and Salerno came scholars not only from the rich countries of the East, like Syria, Egypt, Iran and Afghanistan, but also from developing lands of the West, like Scotland and Scandinavia. Then, as now, there were obstacles to international scientific collaboration, with an international intellectual disparity between different parts of the world. Men like Michael the Scot or Henrik Harpensteig were singularities. They did not represent any flourishing schools of research in their own countries. With all the best will in the world, their teachers at Toledo and Salerno doubted the wisdom and value of training them for advanced scientific research. at least one of his masters counseled young Michael the Scot to go back to clipping sheep and to weaving woolen cloths. After 1350, however, the developing world loses out, except for the occasional flash of scientific work, like that of Ulugh Beg, the grandson of Tamerlane in Samarkand in 1400 AD, or of Maharaja Jai Singh of Jaipur in 1720, who corrected the serious errors of the then Western tables of eclipses of the sun and the moon by as much as 6 minutes of arc. As it was, Jai Singh's techniques were surpassed soon after with the development of the telescope in Europe. As a contemporary Indian chronicler wrote, with him on the funeral pyre, expired also all science in the East. And this brings us to this century, when the cycle begun by Michael the Scot turns full circle. And it is we in the developing world who turn westwards for science. As Al-Kindi wrote 1,100 years ago, it is fitting then for us not to be ashamed to acknowledge the truth and to assimilate it from whatever source it comes to us. For him who scales the truth, there is nothing of higher value than truth itself. It never cheapens nor abases him. Ladies and gentlemen, in the spirit of Al-Kindi, that I start my lecture with a sincere expression of gratitude to the modern equivalents of the universities of Toledo and Cordova, which I have been privileged to be associated with, Cambridge, Imperial College, and the center at Trieste. Thank
you. And in the words of Abdus Salam, I thank you all book lovers for being here and to all our readers. Thank you very much.